Hello and welcome to my 7th C++ programming tutorial. My name is Eric and in today's episode, I'm going to be teaching you about strings. Now back in episode 4 of my C++ programming series, I gave a quick and teaser introduction to the string data type near the end of the video. Now in today's episode, I'm going to be teaching you about the string data type as well as some of the built-in functionalities that comes in with the built-in string library. So what is a string anyways? A string represents a sequence of characters, such as words and sentences. Note that you can't do mathematical operations on the numbers stored in a string, because the numbers stored in a string is represented in an ASCII format. And in order to perform mathematical operations on them, you would first have to convert them into a numerical data type, such as an integer. There should be a function that will allow you to do this, but we won't get into that today. Now, in order to use strings in C++, you'll first need to include the string library at the top of the program. You can do this by typing in include string. Simple, right? And then within the main function in your program, you can create the variable of string, let's say message. And then let's give it a value. So message is, this is my message. And then let's see out the message, followed by an end line, just to make it look nice. And compile. Yes. And as you can see, the console window shows this is my message on the screen, which is correct. Okay, so far so good. Now let's say, what if we want the user to enter something into the console window? You're probably thinking, we can use this SeeEnd function, right? Well, not exactly. Let me show you. So SeeEnd message. And then before that, let's tell the user, please enter a message. And then let's see out the message. The message is message end line. And then let's compile it. Okay. Hello world, this is my new message. Enter. And notice how when I pressed enter, the message that shows is just hello, which is the first word of the sentence I typed. Now why is that exactly? I mean, SeeEnd takes in the user input and clearly I typed in more than just a word, right? Well, that has to do with the way SeeEnd works. SeeEnd detects the end of an input based on the first white space. So what this means is, the moment we press the space button after the letter O in hello, that's when SeeEnd says, okay, I guess that's where your input stops. And that's what happened. So that's why hello is stored and displayed, but not world, this is my message. So how do we fix this exactly? Well, instead of using SeeEnd, we're gonna have to use a function called the getLine function. So we could delete the SeeEnd line of code, replace it with getLine. And then inside the parentheses of the getLine function, the first parameter you would type in is SeeEnd, followed by a comma, and then the variable of the string message. And then if we run this again, give it our message, hello world, this is my message. Enter. And voila, as you can see, it showed the entire sentence this time. Hello world, this is my message. So let's say we want to do a few more things with strings. Let's say we want to copy strings. In that case, what we would want to do is create a few more variables. So let's say string message 1, string message 2, string message 3. So what we did right now was create 3 string variables. Let's give message 1 a value of hello, and then message 2, we'll give it a value of world, and then message 3 will leave it blank for now. Okay, so whenever you want to copy strings, you have 2 methods to choose from. One is using the equal operator, and the other one is to use the assign function. So I'll show you the first method. So method 1, equal operator. So to do this, you would simply do, let's say we want to copy message 3. I mean, let's say we want to copy message 1 and store the value into message 3. So how we would do that is we type in the variable we want to contain a copy of the message. So in our case, message 3 equals, and then the variable we want to copy, we'll choose message 1. So in this case, message 3 will take a copy of whatever stored in message 1. And let's see out message 3. And let's compile it and run it. As you can see in the console output, it shows hello, and message 1 has hello. But remember, this is cout message 3. So what we actually see is the value of message 3. Okay, so copying works. So let's say we want to use method 2, which is using the assign function. So method 2, assign function to copy values. Okay, in this case, let's do the same thing again, which is copy message 1 and store it to message 3. So message 3 dot assign parentheses message 1. So the format is you take the variable that you want to store something with, followed by the dot assign function, and then inside the parentheses you put in the variable you want to make a copy of. So in our case, it's message 1. And let's see out message 3, and let's compile it and run it. And as you can see, it shows hello. Well, let's add an end line first, and then it'll look exactly like our previous value. Okay, there you go, it shows hello. Perfect. So now you have learned two ways on how to copy strings from one variable to another. Now let's say we want to do something more with strings. Let's say we want to concatenate strings. For those of you who don't know, concatenate is a fancy word for saying combining strings. In our case, so in order to concatenate strings or combine strings, this is what you would need to do. So let's say we want to combine message 1 and message 2, so it shows hello world when we see out it, but we will store that combined message in message 3. So what we would need to do is think of it like math. So message 3 equals message 1 plus message 2. So the plus sign is what you would use to concatenate or combine message 1 and message 2. And the equals sign will allow you to store that value into message 3. So let's see out message 3 followed by an end line just to make it look nice. Compile, run, and there you have it. It shows hello world. And notice that the word hello and world does not have a space in between. That's because the values stored in message 1 and message 2 did not have a white space. So if you want a space, you're going to have to type it in there. So let's say message 1 and then add a white space in hello, and then compile, run it. And then there you go. There's the space between the hello and the world words. Now, a cleaner method to do this is to, let's change it back so it has no spaces. And then inside the message 3 equals message 1 plus message 2, you would add a white space in between, and then followed by an extra plus sign. And then we keep everything else the same. Compile, run, and now it'll show hello space world. Perfect. So far we've learned how to copy strings, concatenate them, and now let's learn one more thing, and that is to figure out the length of a string. So let's see, concatenating strings, and let's comment that out for your reference. I'm gonna keep it there. Okay, so let's say length of string. To find the length of a string, you would use the size function. So let's say we want to find out the the length of message 1. So to find the length of a string, you would have to use the size function. And let's see out that value so we could see it on the screen when we compile it. So see out message 1.size, parentheses, and then end line just to make it look nice, and then compile and run. And as you can see, the console window shows the value 5. And in the word hello, it has 5 characters. So that's H-E-L-L-O, giving you a total of 5 characters. Okay, so let's say we change the message 1 into hello world. So hello world with a space in between. We keep the length the same, the length code the same. And then we compile and run it. And this time it shows 11. But wait, aren't there only 10 letters, not 11? Well, the thing with size is it counts every character in the string. So in our case, the white space is what's making up that 11th number in the size. Okay, now that you've learned how to find the length of a string, let's do something useful with it, shall we? So one thing we could use this for is to check the length of a password. I'm sure whenever you create a new account, the form would usually ask you to create a password that is at least 6 characters long. So let's create that, shall we? We can do that by using the if statement combined with the size function that we've just learned. So let's create a variable called string password, semicolon, and then let's create the if else statement. So if password. No, actually, before we do that, we're gonna have to get the user input first. So, get line cin, comma, password. And then before that, let's tell the user, please enter your password. Or let's, please create, please type your password, please type your password. Okay, and then let's do the if else check. So if password dot size is less than 6, that means the password is too short. So see out the password is too short. Make sure it's at least 6 characters long. End line, just to make it nice. And then otherwise, see out the password is valid. Good job. End line. Okay, so let's compile and run the program. As you can see in the console window, it's telling us to enter our password. Let's type in 12345. Enter. The password is too short. Make sure it's at least 6 characters long. And as you can see, our password was 12345, which is 5 characters long, not 6. So it's invalid. Okay, so let's run this again. And this time, let's give it a longer password. 12345678 9. So that's 9 characters long. Enter. The password is valid. Good job, which is greater than 6. So as you can see, this is what you can use for the size function, and that is it for today's lesson. And that is it for today's video. Please be sure to leave a thumbs up if you liked this video, and subscribe if you loved it. Stay tuned for more videos like this. Good luck, and I'll see you next time.